Good afternoon, and you're very welcome to today's meeting of Rotary Kilkenny. We are very fortunate to have been joined by Tomm Moore, the director of Cartoon Saloon, and one of the creative minds behind their new film, Wolfwalker.
Well, the Wolfwalkers is opening anyway, so
yes,
people can go
tomorrow,
to that.
I think we'll be
I tried it out with my granddaughter yesterday and tried to convert her from Frozen to Cartoon Saloon, but she enjoyed it, I think, you know. But she was mostly impressed that Anna was named Anna, like Anna from Frozen.
These are the icons of today.
Yes, exactly.
Anyway, I'm going to start the meeting, if I may.
Okay.
We've got a good crowd joining in with us already, and more will come. I'd like to welcome Tomm Moore, director of Cartoon Saloon, based here in Kilkenny. And this is a prestigious time for Cartoon Saloon because their film, Wolfwalker, will be launched on Apple TV on the 11th of December. Tom, first of all, you're very welcome to us today.
Thank you
for also doing the dry run earlier today.
Yeah.
To make sure that
About last time, yeah.
Listen, it's worked out perfectly well. I think we have more people able to join us today. I know that you have a couple of things that you want to show to us. But I just want to put a few things in perspective, first of all. You came from Newry originally as a child and settled in Kilkenny. When did you get involved in Young Irish Filmmakers?
I had like dual reasons to join Young Irish Filmmakers. I heard there was girls there. And I was in an all-boys school. That's where I met my wife, Lieselot. And I wanted to get involved in trying to make animation and make films and stuff. So I just started secondary school. I guess I was 12.
What Mike Kelly did in Young Irish Filmmakers was really phenomenal. They really set a national standard for engaging young people. But you wanted to be an animator. Does that mean you were drawing from when you were a child?
Yeah, I went through a phase in my younger childhood where I really wanted to be an animator, and I knew very little about it. It was pre-internet time, but I'd kind of figured out from books and stuff that I needed cells and things. And so my dad used to buy me the supplies in exchange for washing the car, you know, on a Saturday. So I had all the kit except a camera. So I needed to join Young Irish Filmmakers to get a camera. And then by the time I joined Filmmakers, it was the 90s. And actually, we were already, we hooked up the camera to an Amiga, an early computer. And we did our first tests that way. But at the same time, by the time I was a teenager, I had visited the Don Bluth studio and had gotten a bit disillusioned with animation. It felt very factory-like. And I started to focus more on comics. And I ended up spending a lot of my time making comics. We even published a comic up in Young Irish Filmmakers, a group of us, you know. So when I went to college in Ballyfermot, I kind of got the bug again, you know. But I went to college in Ballyfermot kind of thinking animation would be a good like training to be able to draw well enough to make my own comics, because I kind of was, myself and Ross Stewart, who co-directed Wolfwalkers with me, we both had kind of decided that it would be factory-like to work in animation compared to comics. But actually, we were lucky enough that things were changing and it was more possible to tell your own stories without being Walt Disney with animation. So,
Then one of the things that fascinated me was one of the talks that I went to during the Breadwinner in the Butler Gallery, where it showed that it took something like 3 weeks for 10 people to do a 10-second scene. to get the houses moving behind someone, someone appears to be just walking along the street. How does animation work? I mean, it's not just drawing a picture and letting it move. You have to do each movement separately.
Well, yeah, the kind of animation we do anyway, we still do hand-drawn animation, albeit that we kind of draw on screens and stuff. I have a little bit about that prepared to show in my talk. But so it's 12 drawings a second per character. Minimum, and maybe an animator would do between 6 and 8 seconds a week. So that's why you end up with big teams over several years to make it. And then, the stuff like all the backgrounds and everything. And we use computers more and more to make the process more efficient, you know. So, but it's still pretty labor intensive. And the stuff we're known for in Kilkenny is much more craft based than say like a Pixar or something, be more technology based. So although we use technology a lot, we're still kind of doing it to a large extent the old fashioned way, which is pretty labor intensive, but we hope it's kind of more timeless as well, you know, that it won't, like the thing is, I always say that if you look at Toy Story in 95, we all thought that was just amazing. If you look at it now, it looks quite ropey, but you look at Bambi from 1940 and it still looks gorgeous because painting and drawing, you know, is always as good as the artist, and you're not limited by the computer software. Where I think the computer software every year seems to improve so much that, you know, so that's my philosophy anyway.
Without taking the humanity out of it, you know, computers.
Yeah, and at the same time, there's amazing stuff done. I do love, and I have friends who work in it, and the Brown Bag, for example, in Dublin are doing great stuff. But just for me personally, I suppose artistically, I just prefer drawing, really.
Yeah, good. So I know you have a presentation, so I'm going to let you start with that, and then I might come back in with some more questions towards
and
the
maybe, if you want to interrupt me and point me in a different direction as I go through, just to make sure it's relevant, you know.
Oh, no, I'm sure it'll be fine. Thank you.
And I'll do about 20 minutes, and then we can do a little Q&A or something, and we can do a clip at the end from Wolfwalkers, yeah?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so let's start. This time it'll work. I'm so sorry about last time, everyone.
Don't worry.
Okay. Share this. So now, are ye seeing my screen now?
Well, we see Cartoon Saloon estimated in Dead Tree, Kilkenny.
We were actually founded in 1999, so 21 years ago now, but we always say it's a funny imagined beginning for Cartoon Saloon. But I'm just gonna go through the studio's history a little bit, and a bit through my own kind of personal creative process and how that's informed the features I've directed here. So I suppose that, where are we going? Don't tell me we have another technical issue today. Oh, here we go. So these are the two films that I directed or co-directed. Secret of Kells I did with Nora, Song of the Sea I directed myself. They're kind of probably the two features that I'd be most associated with, or the two projects I'd be most associated with in the studio. And now I've done Wolfwalkers with Ross, that's coming out soon. But I mean, the studio does a lot of things beside the features. The features are kind of a flagship, you know, but we do a lot of stuff. Like we did TV shows are kind of the backbone of the studio. And we've set up a sister studio, a Lighthouse, over in Kieran's College and in the old seminary, and that's bigger than Cartoon Saloon now, you know. They've 200 and something people there, all focused on TV animation or series animation. It's rarely actually for TV, it's usually for the streaming services like Netflix and Amazon and so on, but series stuff, and that's kind of the bread and butter of the studio. But these are what's also kind of cute is the cross-pollination, I suppose. Like Chris O'Dowd went to school with Paul, my partner Paul Young, up in Boyle in Roscommon, and then he got in touch with us to do the animation for Moonboy that he was doing for Sky. And then the little lad David Rawl, who played Moonboy, ended up being the voice of Song of the Sea. So there's a lot of that kind of cross-pollination between projects.
Yes, interestingly, one of the people who's a member of Rotary is Declan Murphy, Nick Vincent Murphy.
Yeah. And he's brilliant now, and he and Nick has done so much with us. He's the head writer on Dog Vandango, our new TV series for Nickelodeon, he's brilliant, Nick. And the fact that he's from Kilkenny and he's Chris's writing partner, and so Chris then does the narration for Puffin Rock, which is our preschool series on Netflix. So maybe more people who have small kids would know us through Puffin Rock. And many moons ago, back in 2006, 7 and 8, we had a series on Cartoon Network called Skunk Fu, which is kind of a bit forgotten now, but for us it was huge. It was our first TV show, and it was sold to 100 different territories. So and on the TV side of things, it was Skunk Fu that kind of put us on the map, where Secret of Kells was more on the feature side. But yeah, here's young Irish filmmakers in the early days that we were talking about. And the thing is that Paul and myself and Nora and Aidan Hart that you'll see here, Barry Reynolds, Jeremy. It looks very dated now. It's hard to believe, but it's 21 years ago. I'd been a member of Young Irish Filmmakers, and Paul and I had a little, sole trader company going on in our bedrooms in college, and that was Cartoon Saloon. But then when we came down to Young Irish Filmmakers, we got some funding from FOSS towards making the film for the Millennium Arts and Culture Project, and they gave us some space in Joseph's studios where they were. So as you can see, it was all drawing boards back then. And then, yeah, you can see the computer. Paul had the computer in the corner back then. So it was all pen and pencil back then. And a lot of our friends from college were kind of going into video games, and it seemed like everybody was moving towards computers. So for us to set up in Young Irish Filmmakers was an opportunity to kind of keep going with hand-drawn animation that we really cared about. And Aidan and myself, Aidan created Skunk Fu, but originally we came up with the idea that was become the Secret of Kells. Aidan kind of decided to focus more on Skunk Fu, and actually now he's a novelist and a sculptor, but a very talented guy I was lucky to grow up with as well. And we'd been in Young Irish Filmmakers too. And then, so just to show, we moved from these light tables that we bought from the Don Bluth studio and Jimmy Murakami studio in Dublin. They were closing down and we bought all their drawing tables cheap. And I think Paul always tells the story that they were shaking their heads as we carried them out, thinking we were mad setting up a hand-drawn animation studio at the time that they were shutting down. But now this is how we were. This is actually my Cintiq I have here in front of me. And this is the way, like, I still draw, and we do a lot on paper, but a lot of the work I do is actually just drawn directly onto the screen. So then you just move from paper to drawn directly on the screen. It's the big change, I suppose. And then this is us now, or fairly recently, at the festival last year. Nora and Paul went to college with me. Nora directed The Breadwinner, and Paul's mostly been a producer. And then about 7 years ago, we hired Jerry Sheeran. Jerry's like the grandfather of Irish animation. He was actually the managing director of the Don Bluth studio. So he's kind of been in animation in Ireland on the business side since the very early days. So we were delighted to be able to hire him. And he's changed the studio, I think, from being a very kind of flying by the seat of our pants in a very arty operation to being a bit more disciplined on the business side. And he's been a big part of the growth over the last 6 or 7 years. But then this is like early stuff for myself that I did when I was about 22 or 23. I illustrated a series of graphic novels in the Irish language about St. Patrick. And they were published by Clo Mayo, and they won some awards, and they were on the International Books for Young People list. So they were distributed to libraries all over the world, which was a great success for me early on. And also was kind of the start of it's been like 20 years now. I've been working in my own personal work with a lot of Irish folklore and history and stuff. And this was maybe the start of it. So there were some ideas in these comics that kind of found their way into the movies. And you can see early on experimenting with Photoshop, put the Book of Kells as a pattern on this girl's dress, things like that. But very old now, but at the time they were a big deal for me. And then these are just some of my sketchbooks, because kind of just to show that the backbone of what I do is still drawing, and it's kind of the reason I'm in the business is I want to draw. And I'm actually taking a sabbatical this year now to do life drawing, because I think life drawing for me is the backbone of everything. And this is from the early days of the studio, and we had to pose for each other before we could afford a model. But now we have a regular, well, pre-COVID, we had regular life drawing in Kieran's college. And I always feel it's fantastic, kind of revenge of the nerds, because when I was in college, I was the weirdo for being into art and stuff. Everyone was into hurling. But now we filled Kieran's college up with a load of artists, and we do our life drawing and have our film nights and all there. So these would all be like studies of my favorite artists, like Egon Schiele and Gustav Klimt. And then this is kind of me mixing in some of those influences of the Vienna painters into my own work. You know. And then this is another part of that I usually show, to kind of show kind of the reverse engineering that I might do. These would be studies of the Royal Tenenbaums by Wes Anderson. So I just usually would pause the movie and then draw each frame. And in that way, you'd kind of deconstruct how they put them together, you know. And then over here, this will show you how old these drawings are. This is my son. He's 25 now. He was about 10, and he used to sit beside me and draw with me. So these are his interpretations, which I always thought were really cute. his interpretations of the movie. That's kind of my personal practice, and then I'll just talk more about the way I work as a director within the studio. Secret of Kells, originally called Brendan and the Secret of Kells, was our first feature, and it was what we had kind of set up the studio then in Kilkenny to do. The idea was kind of to make the feature film and to fund the feature film by doing like commercials and jobs on the side. And this is, we thought this was a great idea in the naive way you are in your 20s. And it didn't quite work out like that. But what ended up happening was we wanted to make a feature based on Irish art and take our influence from the Book of Kells, because we thought that all the Celtic knotwork and all the Celtic designs that you see all could be traced back to the Book of Kells. And I remember myself and Aidan going to a lecture in Trinity College about the kind of history of the Book of Kells, and we thought there was about 10 different movies you could make out of it. And so that was kind of the dream project. We wanted to kind of reinvent hand-drawn animation in the face of computer animation and try and find a way to keep hand-drawn animation going, even though Disney and a lot of them at the time were turning their back on it. We thought we could, in the naive ambition of youth, we said we'd come up with a style that could only be done in hand-drawn, and we'd take our influence from the Book of Kells. So that was the dream project, and it kind of just evolved away in the background. These are all designs I would have been doing anytime I got a chance. While we mostly were working on commercials and bits and pieces of other people's movies and whatever it took to kind of pay the bills. And eventually we showed all this artwork and a trailer that we'd made in 2001 at an event called Cartoon Movie in Potsdam in Germany. And that's like every year, all the different cartoon studios around Europe would get together. And it's like a co-production forum. And what you do is you kind of hope that you can find partners in similar size studios, and they might want to take a punt and get involved in your production. And so I was very lucky that year, Didier Brunner and Vivian van Fletteren, who were the co-producers of a lot of successful European arty kind of features. They'd even gone to the Oscars with the Belleville Rendezvous. And Didier was kind of known as someone who took risks. And the fact that he took us under his wing and said he'd co-produce with us was fantastic, because it suddenly meant we weren't just a bunch of guys straight out of college trying to make a film, but we had a serious established producer with us. And when he got involved, that made RTE and the film board and all the local funders here take notice, and they kind of got on board. And so by 2005, we pulled the finance together between here in Ireland. At the time we had the BAI, which is Broadcasting Association of Ireland, the Irish Film Board, RTE, and we raised some money through the Section 481 tax incentives. And then France and Belgium did a similar thing. They kind of put money together. So it's kind of Franken-finance, we used to call it, bits and pieces of money from all over. And we'd all kind of pull it together and kind of, and then we would be able to produce the project. So that was the first film, and it came out in 2009, or came out in 2008, the end of 2008, just as the country was crashing down. I remember being over in Los Angeles. I'd won this prize at the Directors Guild of America, and they kind of showcased a young director. I was about 29 or 30 at the time, and I remember my first ever meeting in Los Angeles. I was talking to an agent, and he had all his artwork from his office all packed up on the ground. And between the lines, the guy from the Irish Film Board who was with me was saying, they're going out of business. So it was a mad time to release a movie. But bit by bit, it did well. It picked up awards in different festivals and stuff. And we ended up being nominated for the Oscars, which was just crazy, because even in terms of the timing and all, that year some of my heroes were nominated. So I got to meet Pete Docter, who's now the head of Pixar. At the time he had directed Up, Henry Selick, who'd done The Nightmare Before Christmas and so many movies I loved, he'd done Coraline. And then Ron John, who'd come back and done the first hand-drawn film, Princess and the Frog, in Disney, since they'd closed down that department. So it was ironic that I ended up there with some heroes of mine who'd been on the same track trying to get traditional animation going. And of course Pixar won, but it was a great experience. So here I am, my uncle always takes a piss there, from a good farming background up north, and he always says, "Good man, Tom, you know not to stand behind a bullock." Yeah. So that's he jokes. But we got to meet a load of movie stars and things, and it was great. And it was great validation of the work, and we kind of felt like we hadn't wasted our 20s. And what was nice about it as well is that I thought that I would be finished drawing the characters when we finished the movie, but I'm still drawing and painting the characters a lot for commissions for people, and people ask me to draw the characters for different reasons. And I did some of these for a charity auction for Aardman in Bristol. So it's kind of nice that the movie has a longer history. Like, it goes back to my teens and stuff in Kieran's College, and then right through being in Young Irish Filmmakers, right up through college in Ballyfermot, and getting the project off the ground. And now it's still kind of alive in a way amongst the fans. And what's really nice is that, you know, we got onto in 2010, we were on the 100 greatest Irish films, and we got invited to the White House for St. Patrick's Day. And I took a sneaky picture of Barack Obama that I wasn't supposed to be taking. And you can see his bodyguard is giving me the evil eye back there. And I met Glenn Hansard, and that's another bit of cross-pollination. Ended up working with him later. And this is the kind of stuff that just I find is just amazing, like fans who dress up as the characters and take pictures, the cosplaying. So it's lovely to think that our projects have such an influence on people that they, you know, I went to Comic-Con in San Diego, and there was a load of people dressed up as Aisling, the little fairy from Secret of Kells. So that was really amazing, gratifying. And of course, the most important thing is, you know, I got sent these pictures. A little girl wanted a Secret of Kells birthday cake for her 7th birthday, which was lovely. And I get sent kids' drawings all the time of the characters. And like, I was so inspired by the Don Bluth movies. I remember going to see them playing in Kilkenny Castle and stuff as a kid. So I love thinking that kids are inspired by our movies now, you know. So that's really nice. But then the Oscar nomination, honestly, at the time I was looking at taking a position in the States, and kind of the company was struggling hard at the time. And we had to kind of borrow from family and friends and things to kind of keep the show on the road. But I kind of had some offers in the States that I was seriously considering, but the Oscar nomination kind of made me feel like I'd give it another shot. And I already had the idea for Song of the Seas. So we were kind of galvanized by the Oscar nomination to keep going. And we'd kind of righted the ship a little bit of the studio. And it was around the time that we finally got, kind of did a struggled on. It was a funny time. Like we had all the recognition with the Oscar nomination and all the awards and all, but the business itself was struggling. We were really just tipping along with a very small team. We'd grown up to about 80 people during the production of Skunk Fu and Secret of Kells, but then between 2008 and us not being great at sort of having something lined up afterwards, we ended up having to shrink right down to about 10 people. And we made a short film, and we did bits and pieces of work on like Top Cat the movie or whatever work we could find to keep things going. And then we kind of got financed together by about 2012 to have another bite of the apple, as it were, with Song of the Sea. And that was a co-production again with France, but with Belgium, Denmark and Luxembourg. And it was actually a smaller budget than Secret of Kells. The Celtic Tiger had taken a bite out of the funding that the film board could offer and stuff. So we had to actually make it for a smaller budget. But yeah, it was an idea that had been cooking in my head since around the time I was working on Secret of Kells. I'd taken a holiday down in Dingle. And I remember we came across seals that had been culled on the beach, and it upset my son a bit. And we were talking to the woman that we were renting the cottage from down there about the fact that the fishermen were killing the seals. And it kind of reminded me of the old Selkie stories about how people used to believe in the seals being like the souls of people who've been lost at sea and stuff like that. So it had me thinking then about how folklore that was dying out or becoming kind of a touristy thing, it needed to be kind of remembered for my son's generation again. And I thought like that was something that we could do through animation, where I think Secret of Kells was more just an urge to create something. I had a little bit of a mission with Song of the Sea to kind of reimagine folklore and kind of pass it on. So I started, the film board recommended Will Collins as a writer, and he had just written a screenplay. I wanted to set it in 1987 when I was 10, because it was kind of a nostalgic period for me. And Will had just written a live action film set in 1987. So it was a good batch. We started writing Song of the Sea then. And what we, the way we wrote was, I had like way too many ideas. So I would be doing little sketches like this of the different like moments in the movie, and Will would be writing this script. And that's how we kind of developed the story and kind of pulled it all together. And then Ross Stewart had actually taken a job in the States after Secret Accounts. He was overworking in Portland and Oregon. And Adrian Merjo, who had been one of the background artists on Secret Accounts and who had made a short film with us in the kind of wilderness years, became the art director. And what was kind of fun was that he was from south of France. So he didn't have the kind of childhood memories of Ireland in the 80s that I did. So we had to do a kind of lot of research together. So this would be just an example of how me and Adrian kind of developed the style for Song of the Sea. This would be like a very rough storyboard I would have had of the old witch having her cup of tea. And these are just an example of some reference photos that we went on loads of trips up and down the West Coast and taking pictures of old ladies' kind of houses and stuff. And these would be a collection of designs on paper for the different elements of the house. And then we paint the background in watercolor like this and build up the layers. And then the whole thing would kind of composite together like this in the computer. We'd layer up the character drawing, the line drawing, and all the different elements. And we'd make illustrations like this that kind of pulled the style together, because we kind of embraced the computer much more. Like Secret Kells had all been drawn on paper, but for Song of the Sea, because we had a smaller budget, but also because the technology was moving on, and also because the story was a little bit about mixing the modern world with the old world, we thought it was appropriate that like music would have, you know, orchestra and electronic elements, but also have traditional Irish music. We did that with Keila, but also the artwork would be made hand-painted combined with computer stuff. So this was kind of an experiment that we were doing. This is a little, from one of the research trips, this is me sketching up in Glencullen Kill up in Donegal. And then this is a concept art of that. I used to go on holidays up here when I was a kid, actually, in Glencullen Kill. And then we did a little bit, this is how it looks in the final, like we've got Glencullen Kill down here, but we moved the lighthouse and stuff from Waterford over, and the sleeping giant from down in Kerry. So we kind of just messed around with geography because we could. And then we were lucky enough to go to the Oscars again. And that was really nice because, you know, it had been a struggle to keep going, and it had been a bit of a punt to go for it again with another movie. And the fact that we got nominated a second time was amazing, because it kind of was like a validation that it had been worth staying the course and doing it. And so here's myself and my wife in the limo, and we're all squashed into the limo together. The guy, the co-producer, is in Luxembourg, and poor Nora squashed in down there. But it was fantastic. And then there's Lisa Lott's head again in the foreground. But it was great, you know. We got to go to the Oscars a second time, and it sort of felt like we weren't just a fluke the first time, that we'd kind of established ourselves, you know. And then this is Don Hall. One of the best things about the Oscars is we got to make friends with a lot of the main anime, and like everyone's the same in the animation business. There's no real glamour. We're all just kind of nerdy people who like drawing. So I made great friends with Don, who actually won the Oscar that year for Big Hero 6. And this is him at the party afterwards, pretending to be gloating while Paul pretends to be crying about it. It was all in good crack, good fun. And one of the nice things that came out of it was, I'm just going to play this little clip for you, was that I was asked by Salma Hayek and Roger Allers, who directed the Lion King, to be part of a group project they were putting together based on The Prophet. And because Ross had come back from Portland after working in Paranorman, I asked him to co-direct this little piece with me. And it was kind of like a test run, because I was hoping that I would make Wolfwalkers with Ross and that we would co-direct it together. And so this was like our little test run, and we got to kind of, we had such a free rein with this because Glenn, who I said I'd met at the White House, Glenn Hansard did the song with Lisa Hannigan, who sang the song for Song of the Sea. So they did a duet, and I got to pick the poem from the book of poetry of The Prophet to illustrate and kind of just have a very free rein to make a little 5-minute part. So it was a really nice project to do, and we got to test out a lot of stuff, and not a lot of people have seen it. So I always like to to show it when I'm talking to people because I'm proud of it. Can you hear the music?
When love beckons to you, follow him. Though his ways are hard and steep, and when his wings enfold you, yield to him. Though he hides a sword among them, and when he speaks to you, believe in him.
For us, that was a really big opportunity because we didn't have to do like children characters. We could talk about older themes and the references were really free. We didn't have to draw backgrounds in any way recognizable. We could just work with these kind of abstract painting style like Gustav Klimt and other favorite paintings. So it was a really lovely project to be part of. So that's a really nice example of the kind of work for hire that we like to do, where it feels like we're being asked to do something kind of artistic rather than, you know, advertising breakfast cereal or something. Oh, sorry, that should go on to the next one. Yeah, so anyway, this is Salma who produced the Prophet and on the red carpet at Cannes. I really should pay for the Getty image. writes, and then Paul met his hero Clint Eastwood here, and this guy is the head of the VFX firm that did a lot of stuff like Planet of the Apes. And probably the biggest connection out of that Oscars was Nora met Angelina Jolie, who was an American actor who wanted to co-produce Nora's film The Breadwinner. And so that was a really nice follow-up to Song of the Sea for us, because it was Nora's first time directing a feature on her own, and it was a project she was really passionate about, and Angelina had school set up in Afghanistan, so it was about a little girl in Afghanistan trying to survive during the invasion in 2001. And so it was a really, really lovely project that came out of this period, you know. So what I focused on after The Prophet was Ross and myself, while Nora was making The Breadwinner, we were developing the story for Wolfwalkers, which is set in Kilkenny in 1650. We sort of had the idea, there was a series on T.G. Carr called Wolfland, and it was about how Ireland had been called Wolfland once upon a time, and that Cromwell had made a point of trying to destroy all the wolves to kind of show that he'd sort of tamed the country. And I remember when I was in Young Irish Filmmakers, Angela Walsh, one of the kind of the adults in the Young Irish Filmmakers running the place, I remember just talking to her casually about weird Kilkenny connections. And we talked about the idea that Walt Disney had some Kilkenny connections, and Santa Claus was buried in Kilkenny. And then we were also talking about the fact that there was werewolf stories in Kilkenny. Now, I hadn't thought about it again since then, but when we had the idea to make a feature about the species extinction of wolves, I went and looked up the wolves of Ossory. And there are these amazing stories that have almost completely been forgotten that were written down by a guy called Gerald of Wales in these old manuscripts. And it was this idea that St. Patrick had cursed certain tribes of pagans from Ossory, which is Kilkenny and Leash kind of area, that they wouldn't convert for him. So he'd put a curse on them that when they fell asleep, they would leave their bodies as wolves. So they weren't quite werewolves. They weren't like a half man, half wolf monster, but it was more like there would be these stories of kind wolves, almost like Selkie stories with seals, or people would be lost in the forest and a kind wolf would lead them home or feed them or take care of them. And the idea was these were the pagans. And there's mad stories, and even read somewhere that in the witch trials in Salem in the US, anybody from Kilkenny was immediately under suspicion that they might be a wolf or that they might be a werewolf. They could transform into a wolf. So I just thought that was a great story. And so the idea, you know, oh yeah, and on the art side, it was the first time we'd done talking animals. We had the idea that we could actually do a kind of a Lion King type story where we had animals that were talking, which I always think is a great thing in anime. And it's always nice to challenge yourself. And I had to learn wolf anatomy and study birds and so, because we wanted to have a hunting falcon in it, Merlin. But the idea basically what we had was that a hunter would come over from England with Cromwell to kill the wolves, and that his daughter would be trying to prove herself in this fairly restrictive society, Puritan society, by showing her dad that she could be a hunter too and not just a housemaid. And the original idea ran into witchcraft and stuff that we dropped because it was kind of a bit heavy. But the basic thing that stayed was that this little girl would make friends with a little Irish girl, and the little Irish girl, Maeve, turns out to be one of the wolves that she's trying to hunt with her dad. And the idea was that if you could see things from another person's point of view, if you could see things from the point of view of the so-called enemy, you would change your point of view. And so by her becoming the thing that she, by her becoming a wolf, she kind of sees the world from with new eyes. And so that was kind of the inspiration. And the two themes of like species extinction and habitat destruction and the polarization of society just became more and more relevant over the 7 years from these original ideas. And, you know, it's mad how in the end the film came out and so many people are drawing parallels with like the Amazon being destroyed in Brazil, or the fires in California and Australia, and the polarization that's happening in lots of countries where we were talking about Northern Ireland kind of stuff. That's what we were thinking about. But anyway, it's just so interesting. So we have Oliver Cromwell, Lord Protector Oliver Cromwell, the best boo hiss villain you could ever have, and Sean Bean playing the dad, Bill Goodfellow, and then Robin Goodfellow, and Maeve McTeera and her mum. So these are the characters. And we kind of have Robin go on a journey from being a proper little English girl with her hunting falcon Merlin to becoming a bit wilder and more loose and drawn more loosely like Maeve, you know. So this is Maeve McTeera. And then, yeah, a big thing that we wanted to try out that we started doing in The Prophet, which was that we could use two different styles. And again, this is goes on with our mission, trying to always do things that you can do with hand-drawn animation, which is why I think, you know, the Academy and different animation festivals and stuff like our work, because we're always pushing the envelope a bit of what you can do with the medium. So what we did with this is we tried to make it that everybody in the town, all the English people, looked like woodblock prints, because there was a lot of pamphlets being printed at the time very cheaply and quickly. And then everybody in the forest style, the walls would look like pencil-y sketches and paint and stuff like that. So that was the big artistic idea. And again, with the music, we worked with Keila and Bruno again, and a Norwegian singer called Aurora and Maria Dial Kennedy, to kind of have music that sounded both like chamber music of the time and traditional Irish music at different points, you know. So it was great, and we didn't have to go too far to do the research. We just most of the crew who weren't Irish or from Kilkenny could just go sketching. Actually, at the time we had the studio on Patrick Street, and a lot of them could just go up to the roof and look out across the town. And, you know, we had the castle in it, and then we went out to whatever remains around Kilkenny. We were actually lucky enough to get to spend a bit of time out in Kilfane and stuff, doing research with the international crew. So that was lovely too. And yeah, you can kind of see the idea here that we looked at old maps of the time. We kind of had the idea that as the English colonized the part, it would become like a map and all hard edged and kind of figured out and bored with barriers drawn in, and everywhere they hadn't gotten to yet would stay all wild and sketchy and stuff. That was kind of our big idea for the project. So that's just, it's actually in cinemas soon. It was supposed to be in cinemas at the end of October, but with the lockdown, we couldn't do it. But it'll be in cinemas now at the end of the week, which is fantastic. And there's the exhibition in Butler Gallery where you can see some of this stuff. And then, you know, it's on Apple TV Plus internationally after that. So this was a big project for us, and that was the first time we had a co-production in place between France and Luxembourg again. And Apple came in as partners when we were in production, which was fantastic. And they put a lot of kind of marketing might behind it. So that brings us up to date anyway. So that's my little presentation. What I might show you, actually, if we have time, I think we do, I'll just show you a little clip from the movie. This is with the song from Aurora Aknes, the Norwegian singer, and she re-recorded it with Keila. And she actually recorded it during lockdown, so she recorded it in Bergen in Norway, and then all the Irish musicians had to record individually at home. But it came together pretty well. Hopefully, my little play. Oh, right, hang on a sec. So you're getting a sneak peek.
Why do you want to be here? Being a wolf is way better. I'll show you. Can you smell me?
Of course. Everybody can.
Well, close your eyes. You don't need your eyes to see. And you can hear every little thing that moves. And your paws can hear through the earth. Jump so high!
And my mind still
feels. Hey, wait for me! Are we
running out of time? Keep your nose down! Be a wolf!
All the echoes in my mind cry. There's blood on your lies. The sky's open wide. There is nowhere for you to hide.
Letting them out.
There you go now.
Wow, Tomm, thank you. That's really, really interesting. And, you know, this is going to do, I think, for Kilkenny. What Cartoon Saloon is doing for Kilkenny is a bit like what Kilkenny Design did in the 1960s and established Kilkenny as a centre for creativity. When the Design Centre closed, we all worried about, you know, where was that going to leave Kilkenny? But craftspeople came to live here. Mm-hmm. And what Cartoon Saloon seems to be doing is that it's bringing people to Kilkenny. Kilkenny lacks a third level college, so it doesn't have that transient young population that other places have. But Cartoon Saloon seems to be doing that for Kilkenny, bringing people of creativity to live in the city, to be part of the community, and still contribute so majestically to something that's putting Ireland on the creative map, but particularly underlining Kilkenny's role there.
Yeah, what I love is that, like, when Ross and myself and Aidan were in Young Irish Filmmakers, there was that tiny handful of us who were interested in animation and comics and stuff. We were definitely the minority, but between Lighthouse and ourselves, there's about 350 animation professionals living in the town. And, you know, when it's not COVID time, they're packing out certain pubs like Billy Burns and stuff, you know, so it's nice for me. I kind of managed to drag it, like, rather than having to go away. I always thought I'd eventually have to go abroad to LA or London or somewhere, but I managed to drag all these creative people over to me, so I'm delighted.
Yeah, but it's enhanced Kilkenny's image no end, and I mean, created employment at a time when so many people are looking for work in the creative industry. And animation seems to be different to other art forms at the moment, other film forms, in that you can actually embrace one another in a cartoon.
Yeah.
When you're making it. And I just wonder what the future is in the coming year. You know, there's not going to be an awful
lot live action stuff.
Yes.
I suppose the live action will have to wait for the vaccine to really take off again. But I think they're trying to find ways.
Yes.
But animation is okay. I mean, Nora's deep in production now with a project for Netflix, which is like the biggest feature we've ever done. It's like a 30 million budget or something. So it's like the biggest thing we've ever tried. But everybody's working from home. And what's a little bit hard is that I always kind of insisted on a kind of workshop vibe where everybody worked together and we could all be in the same space together. And the more you kind of have it that people are obliged to move to Kilkenny, but then they can't actually see each other, they're all working from home in Kilkenny, I think it puts a real strain on that idea of like a workshop, you know. And we do these big conferences and stuff and show and tells and all, but I really do hope we can get everyone all together into the same building again, you know. Even though it's possible to work from home, it's such a pity, you know.
Yes. And you miss the, you know, someone looking over your shoulder and saying, listen, would you try this, you know?
Or more even, I get inspired just seeing their work. You know, like, you kind of, now I only see people's work if it's presented to me officially, whereas it was just much more casual that you'd be seeing another project going on in another room that you mightn't be involved with, and you get really inspired. And just a kind of a art school kind of vibe to it.
Yes.
But I want to say as well, like, Kilkenny has supported us massively as well, especially during the COVID, like the, I mean, all through the years, you know, loads of people in Kilkenny have supported us hugely. But during the lockdown there, we had the Wolfwalkers Month in October, and we had the projections on the castle, and we'd stuff up all around town. And it was kind of bittersweet because it's probably the biggest ever presence I felt that the studio had outside of our own buildings around town. But yet it was also a time when people were, you know, anxious and had to stay in and stuff like that.
But there's one thing about something that's going to appear on television screens. It'll bring families around the television set, watching the film, or going to the cinema. Hopefully that will happen.
I would hope so, yeah. I mean, on Friday it'll open in Kilkenny and we'll just see if people feel safe.
Yes.
I hope they would take a risk, like, not take a risk, but take a chance and go and see it in the cinema. But yeah, I understand as well that it's massively, you know, everything is a decision these days, isn't it? Like.
Yeah, it's just ironic, you know, that the biggest cinema, that's probably one of the biggest in the country, opened in Kilkenny just in time for the lockdown, you know, and cinemas are shut, but we'd wish it well. And particularly Wolfwalker, which is, you know, I mean, the fact that it was created in Kilkenny, but also features Kilkenny is a great promotion for the city. I just have one last question about the Oscars. How easy is it to get nominated for the Oscar? I mean, getting the nomination is a big deal. Winning it is a bigger deal, but getting nominated in the first instance is a big deal.
I think we're victims of our own success. To be honest with you, it's not easy at all. But yeah, it's like the hurling team or something. Now it's nearly expected. And the first one that doesn't get nominated will be the one that didn't get nominated. No, it's not easy at all. And the first time was like a mini miracle, because we didn't have any, like, Apple are putting a marketing campaign together now to you know, to get in front of voters. But it just says something about the animation branch of the Academy that they're not to be bought, you know, because they just found, I think it was literally just a few enthusiastic people who were working on a movie in Scotland, who went back to LA and told everybody about Secret of Kells rather than the movie they were working on, because they were impressed with Secret of Kells. And then it got passed around, DVDs got passed around the animation branch, and we had no, like, we had not, we barely qualified. We had a screening in LA and a screening in New York in a kind of a cinema in a shopping mall, you know. It was really nothing. Like, our distributor was two guys who were part of the New York Children's Film Festival, who wanted to distribute films, but they had a wing and a prayer, you know, no budget. And so that first nomination was just just crazy. And it was amazing because it put us on the map. And then since then, we've been a little bit more clued in. Like, I joined the Academy in 2011, and I think we've the highest concentration of Academy members in Ireland, because there's six or seven members now in the studio. Brilliant. And so, yeah.
Well, this, I'm going to ask if anybody else has any questions for Tomm. The words coming in through the chat box is really positive, Tomm.
Oh,
people are so impressed with what you're doing and how you presented this today. But I'd just like it, if anyone, there's Declan Murphy. Declan, would you like to unmute yourself? And
can I have a go?
There's Martin Brett. If you unmute yourself, you can speak. Martin?
Okay, well, maybe I'll come in while Martin is getting ready. Ian, I thought what we saw and heard was just absolutely wonderful. It strikes me that my generation had a very, very poor education in art and visual forms of art of all descriptions. And it was all an emphasis on literature and learning Latin and that kind of thing. I think this is just wonderful to see this. This will blossom art, you know, for the whole generation that sees it. And of course, every generation will see it. So well done.
Oh, thank you so much. Yeah, I hope so. Yeah.
Okay. Well,
can I come in?
Yes, Martin.
Yeah, just a couple of comments. It's worth making the point that there's somewhere over 300 people employed in animation in Kilkenny,
yes,
which is a serious employer as far as Kilkenny is concerned. And then when you look at the fact that, okay, what you have done, Tomm, and your team have put Kilkenny on the map in a different way. You know, you've made reference to the All-Ireland teams and all the rest of it, but it's important to win All-Irelands in other ways, or European or worldwide operations. And what you've done is you were the catalyst in more ways than one, can I say, that when we were talking about Butler Gallery and locating it where it is now and getting the funding, you were the catalyst on which we were pitching everything in terms of it, so that, okay, the art world could come on board and could see where it was coming from. But then again, when we looked at what you were doing, it meant that what we were doing was actually piggybacking on what you had achieved. And I just want to say thank you from all of us for what you're making a difference for. And when you're talking about giving something back, and this is a plug for ourselves, as most of you know who are listening in, I'm the co-founder of Kushnor. And you designed our Christmas card this year, which is a big plug for ourselves now. And it's on its second print. Thanks to yourself, because everybody just enjoyed it. I just want to say thanks.
That's great. Well, thank you so much. And also thanks a lot for your support of the exhibitions and stuff that some of our crew have had. And no, it's great. It's lovely to hear that. It's lovely to be in the Butler Gallery now, I have to say. I just had a photo shoot down there this morning for the New York Times, and it was lovely to be able to show it off in the new building that it is and everything, you know. But yeah, it's class. It's great.
We're joined here by Rebecca Reynolds,
nice,
from the Butler Gallery.
Welcome, indeed.
Rebecca, I don't know, is the gallery open tomorrow, do you know?
Gallery is open on Wednesday, Ian.
Wednesday.
So, yeah, open to the public as normal on Wednesday. So it'll be brilliant to have everybody in to view the Wolfwalkers exhibition. So, you know, we're all very excited about that, obviously.
Great. Yeah, well, I think the two exhibitions that have been held so far in the Butler Gallery have been stunning, and they both have had Kilkenny connections. But this one, I think, I still remember the very best exhibition I ever attended in the Butler Gallery was the Breadwinner exhibition, where we entered the streets of Kabul. And it was stunning. And it just shows what can be done in the space that you're offered.
Oh, yeah.
Tom, we're really grateful for the time that you've given us today.
Thank you. It's nice to chat to this.
And we really very much appreciate it. I've recorded it for those who couldn't attend, because there's a lot of people who just couldn't make it at lunchtime today. So I'll send you a copy of the recording. And I'd like to just thank you very much for all you've done, not for just for us today, but for all that you've done for the arts, and for particularly for the animation art that you yourself have contributed to, along with all of your colleagues. We're really very appreciative and very thankful.
Thank you all so much. I really, really appreciate it.
Very much.
Okay. Listen, I'm going to close the meeting today, and I'll send the recording to everybody. And hopefully next week we have Paula Lawler from the Yulefest committee. And she's going to be talking about not only Yulefest, but how we can be actively involved in it in Rotary through our Remembrance Tree project. We got honourable mention of the Remembrance Tree project when the mayor turned on the Christmas tree lights on Saturday evening. Anyway, listen, thank you all for joining us, and look forward to seeing you again next week.